And I'll repeat this. The meeting this morning will begin with resources and environmental protection issues and so on. The transportation issues will not begin until at least 11:30. So if you're here because you would love to sit through these other issues, that's great. Happy to have you. But if you're a transportation person and you're on that portion of the agenda, you can safely vacate the premises until 11:30, even if we were to finish up a little early. My commitment is to wait until 11:30 to start those items. So we'll wait for just a minute or two before our colleagues get here, and then we'll begin.
Here, just in case there's a vote only discussion, but you would be up first.
Okay.
Usually there's no discussion.
Okay.
But I was just wanting to err on the side of caution.
Okay.
That's all.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much. It's the custom and practice of the committee to start promptly, 5 minutes late, and we are ready at that point. Mr. Lowenthal, I know, is in a caucus and will be along shortly, but I think we can go ahead and begin. As I mentioned earlier, today is obviously our May revision and open issues hearing. Part A of the hearing will deal with resources, Cal EPA, and energy-related departments. And we're going to start with departments where there are some vote-only items and then follow with discussion and various other proposals. I want to move as expeditiously through the agenda as we can. We have a long day ahead of us, and want to make sure that we get to our transportation issues with plenty of time as well. It is the goal to close out all items today. There may be an exception or two along the way, but that is certainly the goal. And what we'll do is, if there are items where we are taking a vote and Mr. Lowenthal is still held in caucus, we'll simply hold the roll open for him and ask him if he'd like to add on later. So let's begin by calling the roll to establish a quorum.
Senator Simidian?
Here.
Senator Fuller?
Here.
Senator Lowenthal?
We have established a quorum. Okay. The first item of business is vote-only items. There are 14 of these on pages 2 through 4 of the originally published agenda. Again, items 1 through 14 on pages 2 through 4. Happy to take those in a single vote or to divide the question if that would be helpful to members. Senator Fuller, what's your pleasure, ma'am? All 14 together okay by you? All right. Then, Senator, if I could ask for a motion to approve the items that you're comfortable with. And is that items 1 through 14 except for item 7?
Yes.
Anybody who needs to talk on these, we've got these identified as vote-only items because we think we need no testimony but want to make sure we don't rush past anyone. Apparently not. Please call the roll.
Senator Simidian?
Aye.
Senator Fuller?
Aye.
Senator Lowenthal?
2-0. One member absent. Will hold the roll open, even though there are sufficient votes to approve these items. Senator Fuller, could I ask for a courtesy motion, please, on item number 7? We have a motion by Fuller. Please call the roll.
Senator Simidian?
Aye.
Senator Fuller? Senator Lowenthal?
1-1. We're going to hold the roll open for absent members. That takes care of items 1 through 14. And then, folks, we have an errata sheet, which is for items under Fish and Game, items 1 and 2. And this was published following the initial publication of the agenda, as I understand it. Why don't we give Senator Fuller a moment? And Senator Fuller, if you're prepared to offer a motion. We have a motion to approve items 1 and 2 on a vote-only basis. Anyone who needs to talk on these items? No? We have a motion on the floor. Please call the roll.
Senator Simidian?
Aye.
Senator Fuller?
Aye.
Senator Lowenthal?
2-0. That is sufficient, but we're going to hold the roll open for absent members. All right. That takes us to Cal EPA. Do we have folks from Cal EPA who are here? And well, we have a staff recommendation to reduce 14 positions at the Secretary's office, with the savings mostly to be returned to the fee payers or to direct enforcement and program activities at Cal EPA. Senator Fuller, we have heard directly from the administration. They understand and acknowledge the need to reorg in this area. However, a new administration, and they've asked for some time. They've made the commitment to take steps going forward, as I understand it, and have asked if we can hold off on this item. I am prepared to extend that courtesy to the administration, but with the clear understanding that if we're having the same conversation again next year, the understanding is at an end. I think, it, as I say, in fairness, got a new administration in place dealing with some budget issues, and they're anxious to take their time and get this right rather than have us do it on a sort of a piecemeal basis through the committee process. That being said, want to turn to you and see if there are any comments or questions. My inclination is to simply pass on this item, having publicly acknowledged the administration's commitment to work this through between now and the time we have budget hearings next year. All right. Do we need to hear anything from anybody with Cal EPA? You're going to take that as a good day's work and vacate the premises quickly?
I couldn't have said it any better. Thank
All
you,
right,
Senator
thank
Schmidt.
You. Okay. You'll go far in public service. Thank you. All right. Thank you. We have a vote-only item on Energy Commission. This is the continuing implementation of Solar Homes initiative. And unless there's objection or any public comment, then we have a motion from Senator Fuller to approve item 1 on page 7 of our published agenda on a vote-only basis. Please call the roll.
Senator Simidian?
Aye.
Senator Fuller?
Aye.
Senator Lowenthal?
3-0. That measure passes. Members, I'm going to suggest that we pause here just to catch up and go back to the items where we've established a roll call vote and ask if Senator Lowenthal would like to add on. Senator, welcome.
This is the
good. Sure. Please read.
On page 4, vote only items 1 through 6 and 8 through 14.
Current vote is 2-0. Call the absent members.
Senator Lowenthal?
Aye.
Item 7.
One moment, please. That's 3-0. Those items are out. Next item.
Item 7, page 4. Senator Lowenthal?
Current vote is 1-1. Chair voting aye.
Aye.
2-1. That measure is out. Next item, please.
Errata page, vote only items, Department of Fish and Game, items 1 and 2.
Current vote is 2-0. There you go. And Sergeant-at-Arms, we've moved from a room that's usually too cold to a room that's usually too warm. And if it's this hot and stuffy this early in the day, I can only imagine what it'll be like by the end of the hearing. So anything you can do to get us a little fresh air would be appreciated. This is the item 3600, Department of Fish and Game, the two vote-only items. Lowenthal, aye. That vote is 3-0, and those items are approved. And we have dealt with Cal EPA relatively quickly. That takes us to the Energy Commission. We've dealt with the first vote-only item. And that puts us at page 8 of our published agenda. And this is the Energy Resources Program account. The item was held open in January to give Senate Budget and Policy staff an opportunity to review the Energy Commission's program expenditures and revenues. And the Commission has met with the Senate staff several times. And I want to think how to phrase this. As I understand it, the staff still has concerns that the Commission raised rates to cover a forecasted reduction in revenues rather than consider program reductions or some balance of the two options. So who'd like to present on this item, just briefly, please?
Yes, I'm Bob Weismuller. I'm the chair of the Energy Commission. I'm here with staff. First, I'd like to thank you for the opportunity to address the committee. And I'm aware that there are a number of issues related to the Energy Commission of concern to the legislature. I'm before you today to assure you that I look forward to working with you to address these concerns. Most concern to us is the recommendation to reduce the Energy Commission's baseline budget by $8.4 million. This amounts to a 2.5% cut to the Energy Resources Program account that supports the Commission's core activities. The ERPA experienced an unprecedented 7% decline due primarily to two key factors last year. One, the economic downturn, and two, unusually cool weather, both of which resulted in reduced electricity consumption, which in turn funds the ERPA. In November of 2010, only after careful consideration of declining revenues and cost cutting, the ERPA surcharge was increased by about 40 cents per household per year. The Commission's workload has increased during this time, particularly with respect to the power plant siting, and also the Economic Stimulus and Energy Efficiency Grant Program. We instituted a number of cost-cutting measures, but we also had to deal with the increased workload. I'm happy to respond to questions you may have at this time, and my staff is here to answer any further questions.
Thank you. LAO, do you have an observation on this item?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Tiffany Roberts, Legislative Analyst Office. We did look at this item, and we found that recent statutory changes have increased the workload associated with the CEC's ERPA fund, and as such, our review found there was a legitimate programmatic need that supports the Commission's level of budgeted expenditures from ERPA. If this $8.4 million is not restored, the fund will likely be insolvent by January 2012.
All right. Department of Finance.
Well, we concur with Jesse McGuinn, Department of Finance. The ERPA fund is structurally deficit. Its expenditures exceed the annual revenues, and they depend on the fund balances to cover their expenses. An $8 million reduction would seriously damage that fund balance that they depend upon. Additionally, in the agenda, there's some recommendations regarding an audit. And we would note that from the Joint Legislative Audit Committee, typically they direct the Bureau of State Audits. They're fully funded for all of their activities during a year, and they prioritize with the help of the legislature. Therefore, they would not need $400,000. The LAO is also fully funded for its staff for the full year. So if you were going to ask LAO to do an audit, they also would not need $400,000. Another option would be to do a contract with Department of Finance, Office of State Audits and Evaluations, OSA, and they could work out a contract interagency agreement with the CEC. If they had the $8.4 million in their budget, they would have the ability to pay for such an audit should the committee decide to do that.
Well, look, we had this conversation earlier in the year, and what we couldn't get was straight answers about what the level of funding needed to be, why the number was changed. We're still struggling to get this information, and all of this may be the case, but if we can't get clear information from the commission, then it's a little hard to authorize the funding. Let me go to the commission. What's your take on doing the audit to try and get a handle on you've got the potential of having a revenue source that disappears. Have you planned for that?
We're certainly concerned. We have a very high priority on addressing that issue. And certainly, I'm was appointed to chair in February. And so certainly trying to address the legislative concerns. And part of that high priority for the administration is dealing with public good charge. But I also have to understand the consequences for the agency and plan. Certainly anything we can do to help work with the legislature to assure your concerns. I know our workload is high, and I'm trying to deal with our responsibilities. But anything I can do to convince the legislature that we're spending the money wisely, I'd be happy to work with you on that.
Well, what are the fund balances that we're talking about?
In the governor's budget in January, there was a $10 million fund balance. If this 8.4 is to be reduced, then it would take them down just below $2 million. So any unforeseen circumstances could throw the fund into deficit.
And someone from the CE staff want to talk about the change in the ERPA rate?
Go ahead.
Yes, we, as a result of the revenue downturn, the 7% downturn, the commission, and this was identified in the fall of 2010, the commission then looked at the significant workload that the chair mentioned regarding the economic stimulus funds and our increased siting workload. We weren't able to correspondingly reduce operational costs at that time, and so we looked to a surcharge increase. And in November of 2010, we at a commission business meeting, a publicly held business meeting, we chose to increase the surcharge from 2,200ths of a mil to 2,900ths of a mil, which relates to approximately 40 cents increase per average residential household.
It also relates to roughly an increase of 33%, is it not?
Yes, and I can address that. The roughly third increase is the result of the fact that the revenues coming into the fund and the appropriations assigned to that fund have been out of balance since roughly fiscal year 2006-07. And so this gap has continued to grow over the years. And and as the Department of Finance mentioned, the only reason that we didn't have to increase the surcharge sooner was the fact that there were sufficient fund balances, reserves in the fund to cover that deficit. Those reserves were higher than normal because of the furloughs, the position cuts, the other operating cuts that we incurred over the last several years.
Well, do we have any witnesses who want to testify on this item? Members, as I mentioned earlier, we have struggled to get good information from CC. My inclination would be to say we have a staff recommendation to approve the $400,000 and to hold open the $8 million expenditure authority. My inclination is simply to hold open the $8 million expenditure authority and hope that between now and the time the full budget committee meets, we can get better information from the commission. I'm still not prepared to authorize the $8 million today, and would like to. Well, I've heard a compelling case made that we don't need the $400,000 if we want audit. So I'm prepared to say zero. I'm more than a little frustrated, as you can tell, on this item, because I don't think we should be chasing the information this hard. By the same token, I'm simply not prepared to authorize the funding in the budget subcommittee level if we can't get the information we need. That's the point of this process. So if that's what it takes, it's not a happy outcome in my judgment. We should be closing out items, not holding items open. But if that's what it takes, then I'm prepared to just say let's hold the item open, move on, and look forward to greater clarity about what's going on between now and the time we get to the full budget committee. Any objection? Anything else on this item from CEC?
Again, I'd like to work with you to clarify your concerns.
Great, thank you. That takes us to page 9. We have a... proposal for four existing permanent positions with responsibilities mandated by AB 32 to be converted to the AB 32 fee funding source. Staff recommendation is to deny the funding shift and, in fact, shift positions to renewable portfolio standard activities on a subsequent item. Who'd like to present on this item and tell us what it is they're proposing?
It's their proposal.
Okay, folks.
Excuse me, Senator.
It's a long day. We got off to a bad start. We need you to kind of step it up. And I don't want you throwing things on the shoulders of your chair as a way to abdicate your responsibility. So you have a published agenda. You know what it says. Mm-hmm. Let's go. Let's talk about what it is you're trying to spend money on, how you're trying to spend it. We're trying to give you every fair treatment and hearing here, but we can't help you if you won't help yourself. So step it up, please.
Mr. Chairman, Rob Oglesby, the Chief Deputy for the Energy Commission. Essentially, what we're trying to do is transfer the funding sources to something that's long-term and sustainable for positions that continue to be dedicated to supporting the climate change rules under AB 32.
Well, let me ask, does the department play a role in regulating greenhouse gas emissions?
No, it's a support role, sir. It's analysis of transportation energy strategies. We evaluate the greenhouse gas reductions attributable to alternative fuels, biofuels, and other alternative technologies. We do inventory support for GHG emissions, electricity supply and demand analysis as it relates to GHG emissions, and provide analytical support to assess renewable energy contributions to statewide GHG reduction efforts.
Well, as I think you know, the subcommittee recently eliminated the Air Board activities for the renewable energy standard, and I guess the issue that's being raised in the staff analysis is why we would continue to fund the function at the Energy Commission.
Many of these activities are not related to the Renewable Electricity Center. This is also relates to the inventory of emission sources from GHGs and renewable fuels. The low carbon fuel standard, for example.
Well, members, the staff recommendation which chair supports is to deny the funding shift and then to take up the allocation of these positions in the next item. I'd be happy to entertain a motion to deny at this time. We have a motion to deny. Do we have any witnesses on this item? Sure. There's the only item in the motion is to deny the fund shift. So that's what we'll take up at this time. Any further comment or questions? Okay. Call the roll.
Senator Simidian?
Aye.
Senator Fuller?
Aye.
Senator Lowenthal?
Motion approved 3-0. Now we are on the next item where staff recommendation is to shift the board positions from the AB 32 activities to this request from the Renewable Resources Trust Fund to approve one additional new position and the one-time contract funds that have been asked for, and also to require the CEC to return in January of 2012 with a proposal for the long-term funding for these positions in the supplemental reporting language. And as we discussed in the previous item, members, these are the positions that we feel could be better directed towards current statutory mandates. And in particular, shifting the renewable energy standard position to the renewable portfolio standard seems a fairly logical shift. So I think if we look back at the governor's proposal, it's five permanent positions and the one-time contract funds. Essentially what we've said is we can do it with one person plus the contract funds plus a shift of the four people that we didn't authorize in the previous place, and that ends up saving us four positions and, in our view, allocating them to the right place for the right purposes. Okay? Yes, CEC?
We understand that this is linked to the item that we just discussed, and we appreciate the committee's recognition of the level of effort it takes to implement the renewable portfolio standard.
Thank you. And I do, I think that bears acknowledgement. I do think there are new obligations at the CEC as a result of the legislation the governor signed earlier this year. That's real work that is within the purview of the CEC, and it's work that needs to get done. So fair enough. Department of Finance.
Senator, we have one question of concern on the recommendation where it speaks to requiring the CEC to return in January. Can that be interpreted to mean that the committee expects to see a proposal in the governor's budget? Or is there a specific issue here that the committee is looking to see?
Well, I think the answer is yes to both. I think the as the language in the staff recommendation suggests, we want to require the CEC to return in January 2012 with a proposal for the long-term funding. That being said, because this is obviously a transitional approach. That being said, apropos of some conversations we've had previously about the separation of powers, I would certainly never presume to tell the governor what he has to put in his budget. So the governor will put in his budget what he wants to put in the budget, what he thinks is appropriate for consideration and subsequent action by the legislature. So my hope is that we'll see that in the governor's budget, but I wouldn't presume to tell the governor what ought to be in his budget. I would, however, say that we ought to take action in this committee to give direction to the CEC that we need to hear back in January in some venue, in some form, what the long-term strategy is here. Is that a helpful clarification?
Yes, sir.
Not what you wanted, but helpful. I got it.
It's helpful. I understand your concerns about telling the CEC what they should or should not propose for the governor's budget. I'm just trying to work out whether you are talking about a meeting, a hearing, a report in terms of what's expected of the CEC.
Why don't we ask for a written report as well as communication with our committee staff?
Okay.
And I think that'll get the job done.
Thank you.
And thank you for that clarification. We have a motion on the floor, do we? All right. Call the roll.
Senator Simidian?
Aye.
Senator Fuller? Senator Lowenthal?
Aye.
Measure passes 2-0. Thank you very much. I believe that completes the California Energy Commission, and we will move on to the California Public Utilities Commission. Thank you very much, folks.
Thank you.
Okay. Who's here from the CPUC?
Doing this.
Chairman, members, I'm Paul Clannon. I'm the PUC Executive Director. We were filing out of our aisle there.
And I apologize. The noise from the back meant we couldn't hear you. I heard that you're Paul Clannon. And after that, I have no idea what you just shared with us.
Present for duty is the summary, Mr.
Thank you. Okay, good. And who's with you, if we may ask?
Let me introduce Ed Kwan, Chief Deputy Director of the Public Utilities Commission, and Paul Douglas, who heads up the Renewables Portfolio Standard section in the Energy Division.
Great. Thank you very much. We have a governor proposal for 10 positions and $2.1 million, including $1 million in consulting services for the RPS program. And let me just say, before we begin, thank you to the PUC, who worked well, I thought, with our Senate budget and policy staff prior to starting work on the new 33% RPS requirement. I think those conversations are helpful in making sure that to the greatest possible degree we're all on the same page.
Thank you very much.
I think the issue raised here is primarily around the distributed generation work. Could somebody tell us what the governor's proposal for the distributed generation is? And then the conversation, I think, needs to be a little bit about where we are on clear legislative policy direction as opposed to simply heading off in this direction without clear legislative policy direction. So let's start there.
Mr. Chairman, let me ask Paul Douglas to start that discussion.
And Mr. Douglas, before you start that discussion, when we talk about distributed generation in this context, we're talking about distributed generation of many types. Are we talking about renewable energy distributed generation here?
That's correct, sir. And just to be clear, when looking over the LAO's analysis and then rereading our budget change proposal, it became clear to me that there was some language that maybe potentially confused the issue. So with regards to the governor's proposal, as I understand it, since I think he's still developing it, it is 12,000 megawatts of distributed generation. It's not clear whether it's customer side or system side generation, system side defined as generation sold to utility for electric retail sale. So in our budget change proposal, we identified the need for additional resources to support DG programs that we had put in place before the governor had articulated his goal. And we had highlighted that the governor apparently also feels that this is an important market segment. And that's, I think, where there was some potential confusion.
Well, let's see if we can untangle that potential confusion then. So is the proposal we've received for work you were already doing, or is the proposal for to accommodate the governor's desire to make some progress in this area, or is it both?
I would characterize it as the resources are needed today to actually administer the program today, and to the extent that our analysis reveals to what extent we can actually achieve the governor's goal, that would also be an additional benefit.
Okay. Are there folks at the PUC today who are working on distributed generation?
I have one person working on it full time.
And then, now of course I'm curious, and are there 100 who are working on it 90% or?
They're working at probably about 120%.
No, I meant are there other people who are working on this besides that one person who's working on it full time? I'm trying to get a rough sense of how many full time equivalents we're talking about on this issue.
Sorry, I don't answer the question.
The answer is one.
Yeah,
one. Okay. One is that's one. If that's the answer, that's the answer. All right. Do you happen to know if the 12,000 megawatts is in addition to or part of the 33% RPS target as you understand it?
I think that is still being explored by the governor's office.
All right. And I guess the only other question is, to the extent that this is part of a discussion about the 12,000 megawatts, what's your feeling about whether or not this ought to be discussed in a policy venue before we start heading down this path?
I think there is, I have been involved with the RPS program from the very beginning, and based on my experience, I think it's important to study the costs, the benefits, and the risks of pursuing a particular strategy, which is why we do are requesting resources in this BCP to explore the cost and risk and the time associated with distributed generation and potentially going beyond if that is what we're asked to do.
Okay. Department of Finance, any comments?
Well, we obviously support the request at 10 positions and that any work that we can do to look moving forward on what the needs are going to be as we implement the RPS, that the sooner we start working on those issues, the better it is for everyone to have timely achievement of the goals.
LAO.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Tiffany Roberts, Legislative Analyst Office. The governor's BCP does cite the distributed generation work as such that it would be to establish programs and processes to put this 12,000 megawatts of distributed generation in place. It also characterizes it as an alternative to RPS. And so as such, this is very important considerations that the legislature has already in the past demonstrated its interest in at least setting the policy in this area. And because of that, we think that it would be important to first be evaluated by the legislature, and then if the legislature sees fit, to provide policy direction to the PUC.
Okay. Do we have witnesses on this item? Senator Lowenthal, question?
Just for my own edification, how much renewable distributed generation do we have today?
And we're talking about an additional 12,000 megawatts. Is that not a position?
That's what the governor's goal is. Are you talking in the context of the RPS program or in the context of the governor's goal, sir?
Well, just existing today in terms of distributed generation. That would be considered renewable.
Distributed generation that is renewable, that would be eligible for the RPS program. We don't have a lot that is actually online. We have a lot of interest in the market space. We have a couple of procurement opportunities happening in the very near future, and an enormous number of people have expressed interest. But we don't actually have a lot of generation that is small, that's renewable online today.
Like, what would be examples of?
In this particular discussion is focusing on projects between 1 and 20 megawatts.
Yes.
Historically, most of the projects that we have entered into contracts with are 20 to, 1,500 megawatts. So there's been a big shift in the market recently where these small projects can participate, and we're exploring the opportunity to what extent this could help us achieve 33%.
Members, here's my thing. Was it advanced energy storage? Am I remembering the term of art correctly? Where we had a slightly similar conversation where the staff recommendation was to hold off, and the chair and ultimately the committee said, let's go ahead and put some bodies in place to begin these conversations and to start developing the work. In this instance, I'm prepared to support the governor's request, but I do think the issue that the LAO raises is a good one, which is, are we essentially making programmatic commitments before we've got legislative authority and direction? And so what I'd like to suggest is that we approve the request, which is the 9, I believe it's the 10 positions, excuse me, and as well as the consulting services, which I don't think is referenced in the staff recommendation in our published agenda, with some budget bill language that would indicate that the role of the position was to explore the efficacy and desirability of programs and policies in this area rather than to, in effect, make policy by the appointment of the authorization of the position. I think that will work for the PUC. I'm seeing nodding heads. I'm going to take that as a yes. And Department of Finance, you think we can make that work?
Yes, sir.
Good. All right. And we'll thank the LAO for highlighting that particular piece of the issue. And now we'll see if anybody else on the committee agrees with me that that's the direction we're going to go in, because I'm going to ask for a motion.
Move to approve the 10 positions.
As well as the consulting services and the direction on budget bill language. And any witnesses on this item? All right. And I think before we go to a vote, just the thing I would say to the PUC is, if we're having this conversation again next year, at that point, it would behoove all of us, I think, to say, and so where are we on a policy standpoint with respect to legislative action, if any, so that we're not essentially making policy through the budget process. Okay. But I look forward to hearing about the good work that is done in this area between now and then. Call the roll.
Senator Smidian?
Aye.
Senator Fuller? Senator Lowenthal?
Aye.
Passes 2-0. Thank you very much. That takes us to the Public Safety Risk Assessment and Analysis Unit.
Mr. Chairman, there's no secret that this comes post San Bruno and the explosion in San Bruno that happened September 9th that killed 8 people. I want to welcome Rich Clark to the table. He's the director of the PUC's Consumer Protection and Safety Division and in management control of this area. As I testified previously this year before this committee, the PUC began right after September 9th with the process of setting new rules in this area and redeployment of resources, and I want to lay out a lot of information here with your okay in the next 30 seconds, Mr. Chair, and I'll let me just lay it all out. The Commission opened a rulemaking in February to ask the question, San Bruno has to be a game changer for gas transmission safety. How does the game have to change? At the same time, the federal government has begun asking that same question. The Federal Department of Transportation, the Secretary announced last week, they would be opening a rulemaking similar to ours in August. So we're about 6 months ahead here at the state level in setting whatever the next generation of gas safety regulatory regime is. We're also investigating what happened in San Bruno to inform that effort. You provided additional resources this year, four new engineer inspectors for the commission. Those people are hired and deployed now. That gets us up to the federal standard, the federal formula standard for California that we had fallen behind.
Let me interrupt, and I apologize. My recollection is we were at 9.
And we're now at 13.
And we're at 13. And the letter that we have from
the... Yeah, I received a letter from Senator Padilla, the chair of our Oversight Committee, asking questions of our, Policy Committee, asking questions in this area. And a couple of the ways that I suggested the Senate to look at resources in this area are included in that letter. One of them is the not
hang
the federal...
Hang on a second, Mr. Cranny, because you've made a statement that I need to understand a little more fully. Yeah. So that gets us to 13. I'm looking at the letter dated May 23rd that comes to us from, or actually goes to Senator Padilla.
From me.
From you, copied to us. Thank you for that. And it says 5.5 new inspectors would be needed to match the national average.
That's the national average of inspectors per mile of gas transmission line. The federal formula includes a lot of elements, but I suggested that's one particular element that the committees might want to consider.
I see. So what you're telling us is that the 13 meets the federal formula, but it would take another 5.5 to get to the national average. Is that
of inspectors per mile? That's
inspectors
right.
Inspectors per mile. So those are two different standards to assess essentially the same need.
The inspectors per mile is one element of the overall formula. Can I just highlight that number also, Senator? So what we're talking about here is fractions of inspectors per 1,000 miles of transmission line,
right.
And it's an element of the overall point I want to make here, which is. The way the gas safety regulation has to change is it has to be rethought from the ground up. As I discussed in the last hearing before this committee, in 1970, hundreds of miles in California, thousands of miles nationwide of these gas transmission pipelines were grandfathered in even though they had never been pressure tested. Perfectly legal, perfectly legitimate under the federal law that we implement out here. That is an example of what the PUC in California now is considering reversing. For example, we now have PG&E out testing, hydro testing, physically pressure testing, 150 miles this year of the pipelines that are most similar to the one that ruptured. We've directed the utilities to give us schedules for how they'll pressure test all the grandfathered pipe over the next several years. So this is a complex area in answering the question of what's the best level of resources and the best deployment of resources to enhance safety is complex and depends on these efforts that are going on in several forums.
So the request we have in front of us is for four positions. And here's my concern and my question. As I look at the information in your letter of May 23rd, if we added just four positions, we would still be a position and a half below the national average.
And two completely separate things, Senator. So the four positions are not inspectors. The four positions are to be our leaders in establishing a new regulatory regime that's based on risk assessment here. Can I just give a couple of examples of risks that are not built into the sort of federal formula that we've been using?
I think this is a helpful and important conversation in understanding what we're talking about. So those 9 people that we used to talk about, what was their job title? What did they do for a living?
They're engineers. They are pipeline safety engineers who do inspections and audits.
So, inspections and audits. The four people who were added, what do?
Same thing. And Mr. Clark reminds me that they also all do investigations of incidents.
Okay. And the four people that are in the budget proposal, what would they do?
They would look across the gas transmission system, starting with gas, and then when we finish that, looking at electricity as well, by the way.
No, I'm sorry. Let me try the question a different way. And forgive me, this is a technical area, and I want to make sure I understand it fully. So the 13 people that we were just talking about do inspections, audits, and investigations.
Yes, sir.
Is that the work that you expect these new four people to do?
It is not.
No. Okay.
No.
What are they going to do instead of that work?
If I characterize the work of the 13 as ensuring compliance with the rules, I think of the four as asking the question, what should the new rules be? what are the actual risks involved in designing, building, operating, testing these pipelines, and how should the rules be changed at the state level? And then, frankly, we expect those that information to propagate to be a big part of the federal rulemaking as well. It's a new direction. It's a game change.
Got it. All right. So just to put your minds at ease, I can't speak for the other members, obviously, but I'm good with those four folks. Sounds to me like you've got a bunch of folks who are out there on the ground doing the work, and you're asking for four folks to say, let's make sure we actually have a thoughtful architecture for review and analysis and inspection and audit, and they're going to be the folks who create
exactly
that architecture
right.
within the organization.
Exactly right.
Then, if I read your letter correctly, that means that we are 5.5 inspectors below the national average.
Of inspectors per mile, that's right.
Even after we do the 13 that we've got plus the four positions that you've now clarified are not inspectors, auditors, and investigators. They're sort of folks who are going to design and oversee the system.
Yes, sir, that's right.
Now, you've also indicated in the same letter that you have essentially a backlog of work to do that has been both discovered as a result of the recent tragedy and that you've pulled, I believe, it's 7.25 staff off their routine work to investigate. Do I have that part right?
That's right, to investigate and help define new rules and all the post-San Bruno activities. That's right.
And then I go on to read that in the page 3 of the May 23rd letter, it takes about a year for a new engineer to attain the level of training needed to conduct inspections and investigations independently. Do I have that part right?
That's right. There's a very rigorous federal training and certification program.
All right. So I always use, my colleagues are very patient with me, or at least usually on this, I always use my, so if I go back home and I'm having a town hall meeting and I got 150 of my constituents in the room and one of them stands up and says, Senator, my understanding is that you are already 5.5 inspectors below the national average, that the need is even greater because you've pulled 7.25 off their current work to investigate the tragedy and assist there, that you've discovered that there's a further backlog, which it will take time to address, and that when you hire somebody new, it's going to take a year to get them up to speed, and yet you took no action to add additional investigators who are in a position to do the investigations, the audits, and the inspections, why on earth wouldn't you be adding people in this case? What should I tell them?
Well, it's not a theoretical question for me. I've been at town halls in San Bruno numerous times since the accident. And, you know, for anybody listening, I do want to say the hydro testing that is now happening, and by the way, there will be physical hydro testing in San Bruno next week of Line 132. That is the guarantee of safety of operation of that line. That is the most important thing that's happening right now to ensure the safety. The question of the number of inspectors that California should have is bound up in this question of how will the regulatory regime work. I mean, I keep on coming back to the national average is 0.17 inspectors per 1,000 miles. Even getting to that level is not going to impress anyone at the town hall. What will impress folks at the town hall is a thoughtful approach to gas safety that's based on what are the actual risks, what kinds of state action are required to address them.
Mr. Grant, I know you didn't mean it this way, but I'm not interested in impressing people at the town hall. I'm interested in giving them a good answer that justifies the action we took here as a committee. So, again, my question is, with all of that staring us in the face, why on earth wouldn't we be adding additional people now to the investigatory ranks, particularly if we're under the national average, you've had to assign staff to other duties, you've discovered that there's a backlog, and it's going to take a year for people to get up to speed, and wouldn't it make sense to get these folks on board? There's clearly work for them to do right now, and then we'd be ahead of the game once we finally hear what the conclusion of the federal and state considerations are.
Yeah, I'm obviously not going to argue against that position, Senator. It makes all kinds of sense. I think what we're at here is a timing problem at the PUC between the results of the investigations that are going on, the state budget process, and bringing people on. I think that's what we've sort of gotten bound up in at the PUC about what to ask for through the budget process.
Finance, what's your take on this? My inclination is, frankly, to suggest that we authorize another 5.5 positions to be at the national average. And given the challenges that we're facing as a state, I don't think average is anything to take all that much satisfaction and comfort in. But let me go first to finance and then to the LAO and then to the members, if I may.
Finance, I can only comment on the proposal that's before you, the BCP. And our view is that it is a first step, and we've prioritized looking at gas and electric. In the future, we'll see a whole new approach towards approaching safety, which is a great beginning. And start with the most sensitive, critical need, which is the gas and electric, and then move on to the other areas such as rail and telecommunications. With regard to the inspectors, the administration is awaiting the NTSB report and guidance from NTSB and Blue Ribbon Commission, which is supposed to be released in August, as well as the distinction between what a national average is and a federal requirement. I believe they are within the federal requirements, but below the national average. So we are supportive of the four positions.
Thanks.
At this point.
LAO?
Yes, sir. We evaluated the BCP. We raised no issues about this particular BCP. Any additional positions that would be added, we haven't conducted that analysis, so we wouldn't be able to comment.
Senator Lowenthal and then Senator Ford.
Yeah. With what you're asking now before the 5.5, you indicate that there's a delay now in routine work. There's a backlog. With the positions, without getting up to the national average, will we reduce that backlog, or will that backlog continue to grow?
The backlog will continue for as long as the extra San Bruno activities are happening.
Okay, so that backlog is going to grow, so we're not going to be doing inspections, and so we're going to be more at risk, for my simple, that the risk will increase because we're not doing those, even keeping up with the backlog.
The routine work is important. It's the
bedrock.
Absolutely.
So with the additional inspectors that Senator Simidian is suggesting or proposing to the committee, what would that do to the backlog?
It substantially reduces it, possibly eliminates it.
Yeah,
we've taken
the one-year training and so forth. We would be able to eliminate that backlog.
That's right.
Thank you.
Senator Fuller.
Well, obviously, I think we want to go forward with all caution, and we want to be in a position that we are prepared to, fully assess our risk situation. I'm a little hesitant to go forward before you have it all planned out, and I understand you need to do it right, but I'm willing to support the chair in whichever direction you go, because I think at the end of the day, our intent for all of us is to ensure the ultimate safety, and whether it's staff up a little higher now, not be exactly sure, or staff a little less and then come back, which is probably what's going to have to happen.
Yeah,
I'm willing to support the chair's decision.
Thank you, Senator Fuller. I think Senator Fuller's point on the safety concerns here is spot on. And look, I know everybody in the room cares about public safety, but I think these are not general funds; these are ratepayer funds. And if there's anything that ought to be top of mind in terms of the use of ratepayer funds, it's the safe operation of the system. If there had been only one or two of these variables that I mentioned earlier in play, I think I might have taken a different view or a wait and see approach. But as I said, when you're looking at the fact that we're still well below the national average, we've got a backlog of cases, we've pulled people off their regular duties to deal with the tragedy, and it takes a year for people to sort of be up and running, waiting a year or, till the next budget cycle to figure out where we are, and then saying, oh, now we're going to catch up, and by the way, it's going to take another year for the folks to be fully trained.
And that backlog will grow.
I don't think that makes sense. And I appreciate Department of Finance and the PUC's point of view, which is, let's make sure we figure out how we're going to use these folks. That sounds like something I might have said at a previous committee hearing more than once. In this case, I think I would entertain a motion for an additional, to not only to approve the recommendation for the four positions, and again, the clarification on those positions is helpful, but for an additional 5.5, can we make that work with a fraction?
Yeah, yes, sir.
And again, with no expectation that 5.5 is a magic number, but or that the national average is where we want to be, but it seems to me at this point it's the least we should be doing.
Especially since you mentioned that 5.5 would potentially eliminate the backlog.
All right. Motion by Senator Lowenthal. Any witnesses on this item? Please call the
I'd just like to point out that based on the increase of 5.5, that we would have to probably do it within a day, run the numbers, because we need to adjust the expenditure authority afforded to the PUC for these additional 5.5 positions and build it in.
When you say do it within a day,
we'd have to have the numbers with the the salaries, benefits, OE&E, right, et cetera, so we have a number to put into our systems for the purposes of the final budget tallies.
Great. And I think staff understands that. We can do that in a timely fashion in connection with our next budget hearing.
We can make that happen.
Full committee and the PUC, I think, says they can make it happen. And we'll just ask everybody to make sure that LAO, PUC, Department of Finance, and the committee staff are all talking to each other so we are all squared away on what those numbers might look like. All right. So we have the motion on the floor.
So
call the roll.
Senator Simidian?
Aye.
Senator Fuller?
Aye.
Senator Lowenthal?
Aye.
Passes 3-0. Thank you all very much.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, members.
All right. That takes us to page 14. And, members, this is really, I would call it a discussion item. I think we're likely to have some witnesses, given the fact that we have a number of boards and commissions that the Mayor Revise identifies as prospects for elimination. The two that have been called out most significantly here in the staff report are the Salt and Sea Council and the Colorado River Board. Staff expresses some concerns. Let's start. Is Department of Finance going to take the lead on this, I gather?
Actually, I'll let Patrick Kemp at Natural Resource Agency discuss.
Great. Mr. Kemp, that was artfully handed off, by the way, by the Department of Finance.
Thank you, sir. Patrick Kemp from the Natural Resources Agency. The Salt and Sea Council, we had some concerns with that because it establishes SB 51 actually established it as a new department within the state, which would essentially have one employee, and that would require us to establish a budget code, accounting, personnel, everything for a one-person department, for a time-limited organization that would last 2 to 3 years, and we felt that was very inefficient to set it up that way. The Secretary supports restoration of the Salt and Sea, and so does the administration, so we just, at this point, don't support the establishment of a new council that has many duties that would require us to establish a department to implement it.
Well, if the Salt and Sea Council was eliminated, What doesn't get done, and who steps up to either do it or leave, or what, or does it simply get left undone altogether?
We currently are moving forward with certain proposals in the Salt and Sea, which are before this committee right now. But I do agree that we would like to move forward with some kind of a public process, and we have a lack of resources to implement that if it's anything close to what's envisioned in SB 51, which establishes a major stakeholder process and different subcommittees to monitor all the different science and everything. So we support a transparent process to move forward, but at this time have no resources to actually implement it.
Let's talk about the Colorado River Board for just a moment. And who would represent the state in state-to-state negotiations if they're eliminated?
Well, the state currently doesn't have a vote on the Colorado River Board. The Colorado River Board is made up of 8 different local water agencies who it's more of a regional basis, and Fish and Game and DWR are ex officio members, so they don't really have a vote. They don't really represent the state. DWR has been acting in that role, and I think would continue to do that.
All right. LAO, you have recommendations in this area?
Sure. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Anton Favorini-Chorba with the Analyst's Office. First, regarding the Salton Sea Restoration Council, we see this as something larger than a simple administrative efficiency question. As you're no doubt aware, SB 51 was passed just a couple of months ago, and that was indicating a certain choice of direction by the legislature. We do, however, see this proposal as an opportunity for the legislature to re-examine whether Salton Sea restoration continues to be a fiscal priority, given that estimates for costs of restoration could be as high as $8.9 billion. Right now, as finance, as the administration noted in their budget proposal, there is no funding plan for any sort of restoration. We would also add there's no funding plan that we're aware of for the required mitigation efforts that could total have been estimated to be about $800 million over 75 years. So, regardless of the choice of the legislature, whether to go forward with restoration efforts or not, we suggest that a funding plan should be developed by whatever implementing agency. If in the case that the legislature decides you're only going to pursue the legally required mitigation, we agree that there's probably no need to create a new state agency. If the legislature decides that it would like to do some sort of restoration above and beyond those mitigation efforts, it's important to designate some clear authority over the restoration that can be held accountable by the legislature, by the administration, and by the public. The council is one option. We have in the past also recommended that DWR could be formally established in that role.
All right. Do we have, let me just ask. There are nine advisory committee and review panels at the Department of Fish and Game, including the Commercial Salmon Fishing Review Board, the Commercial Sea Urchin Advisory Committee, the Dungeness Crab Review Panel, the Recreational Abalone Advisory Committee, the California Advisory Committee on Salmon and Steelhead Trout, the State Interagency Oil Spill Committee Review Subcommittee, the State Interagency Oil Spill Committee, the Striped Bass Advisory Committee, and the Abalone Advisory Committee. What's the impact of losing those?
Fish and Game offered, we had pulled the departments to offer up committees and various councils and stuff that were either no longer existing or they didn't feel were had much value, and that's part of the list, and that's the list they offered. They believe that they can currently do everything that they're doing within their current authorities and don't need these anymore.
Well, and this is genuinely a question, not a not an observation. Should we be worried that it's always easy for folks in the bureaucracy, easier for folks in the bureaucracy to do their work without public engagement? I mean, public engagement is admittedly time-consuming and sometimes messy, but, you know, there's a reason for it. And I'm a little worried that the people we've asked the question of, while they're, you know, good and solid and true professionals, have some reason to think, yeah, I could actually do my job better if I didn't have so much in the way of public engagement required.
I believe six of the nine were either currently inactive, had been active in a long time, and or had run out their time basis and statute. In this case of the salmon steelhead, they have four other advisory boards that also advise on salmon and steelhead that are the, treated more as subcommittees, so that one alone has working groups that already meet. If that answers your question.
It does, and I'm going to ask this next question just because I'm curious, and if the answer is you don't know, that's okay. What's the distinction between the Recreational Abalone Advisory Committee and the Abalone Advisory Committee?
I had the same. I believe one is for recreational divers and the other one is for commercial abalone.
Okay. Thank you. Do we have witnesses on any of these items? Again, this is just a discussion item today.
Mr. Chairman, thank you. members of the committee. My name is Roger Patterson. I'm Assistant Regional Assistant General Manager at Metropolitan Water District, and I wanted to speak to the Colorado River Water Board real quickly. I'm here today on behalf of not only Metropolitan, but Palo Verde Irrigation District, Imperial Irrigation District, San Diego County Water Authority, LADWP, and Metropolitan. These are the agencies that are represented on the Colorado River Water Board, and together we provide all of the funding that is utilized by the board. The recommendation in the governor's revised to eliminate the board and replace it with a local authority is something that we would be interested in talking about. We certainly support the efforts to streamline government. Again, we're putting up 100% of the money for this. We would like to work with the governor's office and the legislature and see if we could explore this. But I think it's important, if we're going to replace the board as it currently functions as a state board, to make sure we get that right, if we structure it as some kind of a regional authority. Because this board is really the voice of California's interest on the Colorado River, dealing with other states in the basin and federal interests. And I've been involved with it roughly the last 5 years, and I think it's very effective in doing that. I do think there are some efficiencies that could be gained in this recommendation, but the board can't be eliminated without having the right structure in place to carry forward. So I would say we would be willing to work on this idea, but it's got to be done correctly, in my view.
Thank you. Are there any other witnesses on this item? Questions or comments from members of the committee? Anything else from either finance or LAO?
Mr. Chair?
Yeah.
Anton Favorini, Chorba, LAO. On the Colorado River Board issue, we recognize some of the concerns of the staff about a state agency stepping in. Just some findings for your consideration as you're thinking about this issue. In our conversations with the board, they stated that there's no federal or state statutory requirement for a state agency to conduct negotiations. In fact, the Colorado River Board and California's position in these negotiations is unique in that Interior contracts directly with the water agencies rather than with the state, as is done in the other lower basin states. However, the board does believe that it derives some negotiating strength from its authority as a state agency. All just right. Some items.
Got it. Thank you. Do we have a couple more folks who'd like to testify on these items? Okay. We can.
Yes, Mr. Chair. My name is Brian Baca. I'm the Vice Chair of the State Mining and Geology Board. I'd like to testify about the proposed elimination of that board.
All right. Briefly, please, since this is just a discussion item.
Okay. Good morning, Mr. Chair and members of the subcommittee. As I said, my name is Brian Baca. I'm the Vice Chair of the State Mining and Geology Board. I'm here to tell you why the State Mining and Geology Board should not be eliminated. First, I'll say that I support Governor Brown's efforts to save money and streamline government. However, the proposal to eliminate the SMGB will do neither. Why is the SMGB on the elimination list? As the May revise acknowledges, there's no taxpayer money that will be saved. And as I'll point out later, it's actually going to cost a lot of state money to eliminate that board. The other reason, or the only reason cited, is that somehow this would be streamlining government. Let me describe the organization established by the legislature in 1885 and expanded upon in 1975 at the time SMARA, that is the Surface Mining and Reclamation Act, was signed by Governor Brown, the same Governor Brown. It's a 9 volunteer members make up the board. They're paid an honorarium of $100 per meeting, and we have 2 staff members. We employ an executive officer who is an expert in what we do, and a person of national prominence sitting next to me, Mr. Steve Testa, and an administrative assistant. So you can know something about us. We've given you a package that includes Mr. Testa's resume and my own. And I point out that the current state geologist was Mr. Testa's predecessor as the executive officer of the State Mining and Geology Board. This board is unique in that it's occupied by a series of people who have specific criteria for sitting on this board that represent all the stakeholders of the Department of Conservation and the California Geological Survey. The mining industry is represented. The general public has a member on that board. Local government is represented, along with geologic experts.
Excuse the interruption. Let me try and help you here.
Okay.
What bad thing will happen to the state of California if this group goes away? I encourage people to come to us with their topic sentence, and you did a very good job of saying we don't think this should be eliminated and we don't think it meets the goals. But then the sort of the next obvious question is, all right, so you're going to make the case, I think, that the state is a better place as a result of this body continuing to exist. So if it gets swept aside, what bad thing happens to California? What no longer gets done? What bad thing will happen? Help us there.
Fair enough. The proposal before you right now is to transfer the functions of the State Mining and Geology Board, which are many, to the Department of Conservation bureaucracy. And what you're really talking about is that state policy on geologic hazards, that is public safety matters, as well as mineral conservation and mine reclamation, instead of being handled and set by a policy of experts as intended by the legislature, it would be handled by a single person who may or may not have any experience, knowledge, or competence in those areas. And so, and then you have the situation where the State Mining and Geology Board serves, in accordance with the legislature's desires, as a forum for public redress. So a lot of issues are handled by the State Mining and Geology Board, that is, public complaints about the activities and actions of local lead agencies, that's cities and counties, as well as the Department of Conservation itself. Well, if there is no board, then those issues be very difficult to respond. You wouldn't have a board of experts. You would have litigation. And so the cost to the state would increase because of this. And you have the situation where the functions transferred to the department, well, they really can't review independently their own work or hear an appeal of their own actions. And so you'd end up with internal conflicts where people are reviewing their own decisions. So there's definitely a loss in money. There's also the loss in the ability of the public to complain and have a public hearing to resolve issues.
All right, thank you. Let me go to your next witness.
Mr. Testa.
I have no comment at this time.
Good.
Good morning. My name is Robert Sidnor, S-Y-D-N-O-R. I'm a California registered geologist, California certified engineering geologist, California a certified hydrogeologist, and I'm certified as a professional geologist by American Institute of Professional Geologists. I've been practicing geology in California for 37 years. I've served both as a private consultant, as a Orange County geologist, as San Mateo County geologist, and a state government geologist. I'm now in private practice. The California State Mine and Geology Board is very small, but it serves as a key a policy setting organization of seven key volunteers carefully selected with different backgrounds to set policy in how we zone active faults, how we zone landslides, how we zone liquefaction, how we zone tsunamis. And these four geologic hazards severely affect the districts of Senator Fuller, Senator Lowenthal, and Senator Simitti. And I've worked hundreds of days in each of your three districts in geologic hazards. And for one thing, say Senator Lowenthal, we had the Newport-Inglewood Fault going through your district, and that was originally zoned was clumsy and way too wide. The Mine and Geology Board recommended it be reviewed. About 10 years later, we got it skinnied down, and so it was this adverse legal zone was much, much better after a second pass-through in your district, a very important active fault. And Senator Fuller, in your district, we have a number of blind thrust faults right there at Wheeler Ridge and the Grapevine and the Big San Andreas itself. And these were then carefully rezoned by direction of the Mine and Geology Board told the California Geological Survey to do that. And you see, you have outside expertise that makes it better for the local farmers and ranchers and the city of Bakersfield and Taft, and the third largest earthquake of all time that struck California was 1952 in Arvin, Tehachapi, in your district. So earthquake ground motion is enormous in your district, and geologic hazards are huge. And so this helps, this small little board sets the high level rules or policy on how all state government agencies proceed in zoning active faults, landslides, tsunamis and liquefaction, and severe ground motion.
And if I could ask you to wrap up, sir, please.
Yes, thank you. It also sits as the review board to nominate the state geologist of California, and would be a good gatekeeper on professionalism within California state government. So the board has a tiny budget. It's nearly all reimbursable, almost no taxpayer money is involved. It's doing a great job. And the 3,000 members of the American Institute of Professional Geologists supports the Mining Geology Board, and the 4,000 members of the Association of Engineering Geologists strongly supports the Mining Geology Board. This is an important small board with a unique function that cannot be laterally transferred to any place else. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anybody else on this item? Still on the same item? Same board? Okay.
Same board.
Okay. And I'm going to ask you to help us move our agenda along in this way. What I heard from the three previous speakers was that it's their view that if the board were to disappear, that the state would lose the expertise, would lose the public forum, would lose the opportunity for an independent review and analysis by a third party, and that the policy setting role would have potential public safety conflicts. So if you have anything new to add, please do. And if not, if you want to say, Mr. Chairman, you seem to have captured it, that would help us save a little time.
Mr. Chairman, Gary Hambly, California Construction Industrial Materials Association. You captured it very well. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Mr. Chair and members, Bruce Mignani with the Houston Group. On behalf of many clients, one of which is U.S. Borax Rio Tinto Minerals, the largest mining operation in California, and you did succinctly capture all of the reasons. Thank you.
Thank you. Anything new?
Yes, Mr. Chairman.
Welcome.
My name is Bill Godwin. I'm a practicing engineering geologist and representing the Association of Environmental Engineering Geologists in San Francisco. Most everything was captured here. I just want to point out that recently, last September, I traveled to Christchurch to witness some of the, as a reconnaissance team, to witness some of the earthquake damages there. And I saw firsthand the devastation and consequences of living in a seismic hazard zone. And the thought of abolishing the State Mining Geology Board is ill-advised and further reduces the public safeguards for the people of California. So I'd like, hopefully, for everybody to consider the facts that the board serves many vital functions and is virtually self-sustaining, and it's needed by the people of the state to safeguard their lives. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Do we have any other witnesses on this item? Please come forward.
Chairman, members of the committee, Christopher Trunell here on behalf of California Trout and Trout Unlimited. I'll keep my comments very brief. I was not planning on speaking today, but due to the nature of the discourse regarding the proposed elimination of the California Advisory Committee on Salmon and Steelhead Trout, I thought I'd jump up here quickly. In short, I think it's imprudent at this moment to suggest that there are these five salmon and steelhead related advisory councils in California, and to choose one seemingly out of the air and say that we shall eliminate that one. Our organizations certainly are all in favor of streamlining the operations over at the Department of Fish and Game and other state agencies. And as an alternative, I will put forward that the Resources Agency and the administration are currently starting to implement AB 2376, a comprehensive look at how to streamline the Department of Fish and Game. And I would just submit that that might be a better forum for both the administration and the legislature to engage in a comprehensive discussion on what public advisory councils and other similar sorts of agencies within state government are legitimate, relative, should be strengthened, should be eliminated, or some combination thereof. And so for those reasons, we understand that you're not voting on this issue today, but we would urge your support for the rejection of this proposal.
Thank you. Before you step away, just let me say thank you to all the witnesses. I know a couple of them have already stepped out, but the whole purpose of having this item as a discussion item when there's no action is to make sure that these issues and observations get raised in a public forum, that we hear them, but that others who are listening on our speaker system hear them as well. That hopefully then leads to further discussion, and we've got representatives from the administration, the Department of Finance, and the Legislative Analyst Office, and committee staff. So that's the reason for it. Let me ask you a similar question to the one I asked earlier, if I may, and see then if committee staff. So the specific commission that you've or committee that you've referenced is the California Advisory Committee on Salmon and Steelhead Trout.
That's correct.
What bad thing happens if that committee no longer exists? How is California a lesser place or worse off in the absence of that committee? That's kind of the question that I ask whenever I get one of these proposals.
I think it's a great question, and in many ways, I'm not sure how to answer that question today. And I think that because no one in this room seems to understand the exact answer to that question, it suggests that a larger conversation should be had about all of the existing advisory committees that exist out there. In short, I know that the stakeholders that do sit on this board weigh in very appropriately and heavily on big issues regarding DFG policies and funding programs, and make sure that there is that sort of coordination and connection with the public in relation to these extremely complex issues. We all know salmon, steelhead issues, coastal, inland, fishery issues are some of the most complex that the state has to deal with. I'll leave it at that.
Thank you very much. Any other witnesses before we say thank you? Comments or questions from committee members? Senator Lowenthal?
Yeah, well, I realize this is a discussion item. Is it possible, and this will be fully discussed in Budget Subcommittee 4.
Right.
Are you also entertaining recommendations to that Budget Subcommittee? I know staff has some real concerns about, especially about the Colorado River.
That would certainly be appropriate if that's...
I would like, I have some of those same concerns to have that more, you know, to at least to highlight the fact that we want Budget Subcommittee to really engage in extensive discussion about and about the maintenance, or the continuation of the Colorado River Board, that we have some concerns, staff has raised concerns about the elimination.
Well, I think, let me confirm this with staff, but I think one way to accomplish that is to suggest to Budget Subcommittee number 4 that they move the elimination proposal to a policy committee for further conversation. In this case, I'm guessing that that's our Natural Resources Committee in terms of jurisdiction, and potentially the Environmental Quality Committee as well. But
I would like a further discussion, really. Right. And if that's the appropriate way to do it, I would be.
Then if you would like to offer at this time a motion that we communicate to Subcommittee number 4, I think that's the way we do it since they have proper jurisdiction, that they refer the Colorado River item to the Policy Committee, then we'll entertain that motion.
I will so move.
All right. Any discussion? All right. Let's call the roll.
Senator Simidian?
Aye.
Senator Fuller?
Aye.
Senator Lowenthal?
Aye.
And for those of you who are wondering what we just did, I would characterize it as essentially a procedural motion, non-substantive. Because of the jurisdiction of the various budget subcommittees, we don't have jurisdiction per se on that item today in this budget subcommittee. We do have the ability, however, to share our point of view with our colleagues in the other budget subcommittee, and that's what we've done now by a vote of the committee. All right, thank you very much. And that takes care of the boards, commissions, and task forces conversation. And we move now to the Department of Conservation. And we begin with what some people refer to as Dogger, and which I refuse to call any organization whatsoever. So, colleagues, you can see on page 16 of our published agenda, the staff recommendation is to deny, and part of the concern here is that we're, for the second year in a row, we're getting fairly major proposals for staffing and change in the May revise, And we had a conversation last year, and while we are on the one hand applauded you for marching forward vigorously to take care of business, I think we also made it clear that it's a little tough when we get these kinds of proposals that what for this subcommittee is really the 12th hour. So let me just begin by saying it's a process matter, if you could help us understand why the department's coming forward with such a significant proposal in the May revise rather than in the January budget.
Matt Almey, Department of Finance. I'd like to take that. I guess the first question or the first response would be, you know, we're sorry. In an ideal world, you're absolutely right. These types of proposals should definitely be part of the January budget and at least the April 1st finance letter process. So we agree with your the staff comments that that's the more appropriate place. What I would say is there's been some mitigating circumstances in the sense that the current administration, it's been a transition year. And as you can imagine, as part of the January proposal, the current administration was just kind of getting up and going, trying to solve a $20+ billion budget shortfall. And sometimes proposals that aren't general fund that address certain positions can get lost in some of the big shuffles. Given the fact that there's also been an interest in streamlining government, making sure that state positions, the growth in state government isn't expanding too much. We wanted to take a lot of time to be sure that each additional position we request through a budget proposal is justified. So those were the circumstances in which we were operating under. And we agree that in theory, it most certainly should have been part of the January budget, but we still think that this is a high enough priority and it addresses a critical need that we wanted included as part of the May revision.
LAO.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Tiffany Roberts, Legislative Analyst Office. We would concur with many of the Chair's comments. The legislature approved 17 positions last year to address this permitting backlog. Dogger's just completed a large portion of the hiring process for those 17 positions. Some of those have not even started yet. And as such, it's going to be difficult to evaluate the impact that those 17 positions have on the workload. Without being able to do that analysis, it's really difficult to say whether or not this BCP is proposing an appropriate level of funding. So as such, we would recommend that the legislature deny the BCP.
What's the department have to share with us on this point?
Mr. Chair, members, I'm Derek Chernow, Acting Director for the Department of Conservation. Along with me is Elena Miller, State Oil and Gas Supervisor, and Ken Lane, our department's budget officer. As you know, we came through last year and we received 17 positions, gratefully, for the underground injection control program specifically. As you know, this proposal in front of you addresses both the underground injection control program as well as other programs within Dogger, the Division of Oil, Gas, and Geothermal Resources. So it includes onshore and offshore activities. It includes construction site reviews in urban settings. It includes all of the things that we've been very, very candid about with this committee and with members of the legislature and stakeholders about shortcomings in Dogger. We've been very upfront about that, and although we haven't come forward with the positions, we've been very clear that we would need additional resources to carry out the duties and mandates that we currently have. What this proposal does not do, and I want to be very clear about that, is introduce new statutory authority, institute new programs, and engage in mission creep, as the folks from finance like to use. So we have provided an honest assessment of what our needs are, and that is what is before you today.
So what will these people do for a living?
Well, I'll turn it over to Lena in a second here, but and she could provide additional detail, but a lot of them are support staff for the work that's currently being done by Dogger. We don't have the IT staff to make what we do accessible to industry, to the public, to provide streamlined and efficient conduction of our work. So there is a large IT component, And then the bulk of them are technical staff. And I'll let Elena discuss those in detail.
Before we get to that, the division, we're talking about all these staff are for the division.
Correct.
Okay. What's the total staff complement at the division? How many people are there?
Right now, we're at 157 statewide, and that includes our geothermal offices. So for 9 offices and for the whole state of oil, gas, and geothermal, I have 150 staff. About a third of those are support staff because of the amount of record keeping that we have to do.
Well, and where's your revenue come from?
Through assessments. For oil and gas in particular, we'll leave the geothermal out of it. Through assessments. So, for example, pennies per barrel.
Okay. So, if I understand, I mean, we're talking about an organization that just got 17 positions, wants 36 more, was in the 140-ish range before the 17 got added,
right.
Which means we're talking about growing the organization by 33% over the space of 2 budget cycles. Do I have my facts right?
Yes.
That's correct.
Okay. And how long had it been at its previous level?
For over 15 years, we went up and down and leveled off at about 119 staff. Those were critical 15 years because during those times, the division was marketing itself to the industry as being able to take on new technology and understand it. Unfortunately, we weren't staffing for the technology, and the industry has continued to progress and to develop more advanced technology. And the staff at the Division of Oil and Gas, and most importantly, the previous leadership, wasn't prepared for that. And so I use the term, it was like a tsunami of work. And it's continued. You know, I always like to say it's a good story for California when an industry that's so old as this one is constantly changing and improving itself and going into places that previous explorers, the prior industry folk, thought they couldn't get to or thought that they couldn't recover from. So engineers for 50 to 100 years have known where there might be oil and gas. They just didn't have a means to get there. IT, the advancement of computers and software have been a key role in allowing this industry to advance. On the state side, the government regulator, me, I was not able to advance because those before me weren't coming and asking for additional resources. And so what we have is a situation where we did receive additional positions last year, and those are critical, and we're extremely happy to have them, and we have big plans for each and every one of them. But we've known for quite some time that we have deficiencies throughout the division, and so what this means for us is being able to address those deficiencies and move forward rather than settle, which I think my predecessors did. This takes an enormous amount of effort, to be honest, and I just think it was easier to let things lay status quo. When I came in just shy of 2 years ago, my calendar was full. The largest companies and the small companies wanted to come in and show me what their plans were and to convey to me that my district offices didn't know what to do with those projects because they were so new. So we've embarked on working on these technologically advanced processes, trying to find a place to work them into our statute and regulations, but it's not without some risk. And most importantly, we have a burden to protect the USDWs under our federal primacy given to us in the 80s and our state program. And there's a lot of information right now, a lot of attention being spent on drinking water, and there should be. It's a critical issue for the state. What so many people don't realize is that my division has a key role in that. A lot of water is used.
Let me stop for a minute. We heard, basically I heard support staff and technicians. Is that a fair
engineers.
Summary? Engineers. Okay. What do these people do for a living? I know what the support staff do, or at least I think I do. So on a beautiful Monday morning in California, when one of these engineers gets up, these new people that you want to hire, what are they going to go do during the course of their day?
I do not, for the offshore, I don't have staff. I've never had staff dedicated for offshore. We are at the offshore platforms and the islands quarterly, doing what we call our quarterly inspections. I have to take my field staff from onshore and send them offshore to do those inspections.
And what are they inspecting and for what purpose?
It's a 21-page inspection for all of the valves, the mechanisms on those offshore platforms. Those platforms are very old. And so we're going out there quarterly to make sure that the boons are safe. If there's an event, a spill, that the equipment will respond. I am permitting new wells or well reworks offshore. I think few people understand that. When a blowout prevention equipment is on a stacked on a well, we go out there and witness that. So we're doing witnessing, we're doing inspections, and when there are violations, then we have to do enforcements.
All right, thank you. Do we have witnesses on this item? We do. Could I ask you to make space for witnesses? Do we have more than one?
Yeah.
If you could just step away for a moment, we'll bring witnesses up, and then we'll let you reclaim your chairs. Okay. Witness singular.
Hi, I'm Bill Alio with the Environmental Working Group. I'm not here to, sort of support the augmentation. I've been working on the issue of hydraulic fracturing now for about half a year, and a method to get harder to reach, as the supervisor said, some of these oil and gas deposits. But it turns out hydraulic fracturing has been used for about 4 or 5 decades in this state. And we think that Dogger's had a blind spot to this technique. They don't call it enhanced oil recovery. They don't call it an injection project. They don't call it a production well. So we think they need to be tracking these operations, these procedures, techniques a lot better. I also, after looking at their website and talking to their staff and understanding their operations better, I don't profess to know a lot about it, is they do seem to have a shortage of staff due to recruitment issues and retirements. So, but I'm not saying they need more staff now. That's up to you to decide. But I also know that in looking at their website, the interface for someone like me, a member of the public, to go and figure out their permitting processes is not good. And it's hard to figure out what's going on. So I know some of this augmentation is to get the technicians and people to make their web presence a lot better. I think that's a needed thing for sure. I can't speak about inspections out in the field, but that to me seems like an area that's been lacking. So with that, I have no recommendation or position on the actual augmentation right now, except to add in the assembly, they are suggesting probably this afternoon language that would add something about their collection of data about hydraulic fracturing. And we would support that over there, but you don't have that before you here. Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much. Why don't we bring you back to the table? One quick question, then I want to go to, I think it was Senator Lowenthal had a question. What's the impact on fees paid by, as I understand it, essentially the cost is passed on to the fee payers.
This is all paid for by industry per barrel assessment. It would rise from approximately 10.5 cents per barrel to 12.5 cents per barrel.
Hard for me to make that translate. Is there a permit what would it do to permit cost, for example? I'm trying to get an order of magnitude here.
There's no application fee. The division is the sole source of funding is through the assessment. So when there's more oil produced, the division brings in more money. When oil production goes down, we take in less money for our program.
And so the fee, again, would go from what to what?
Approximately 10.5 cents per barrel to 12.5 cents per barrel.
Just as a clarifying note, I believe this is correct, but the amount of fee is also based on what the augmentation is. So if more money comes in, then the fee is then adjusted the next year to offset the additional revenue. So it isn't, if we get more money, we have more money to spend. It's adjusted on a year-to-year basis based on the revenue.
Right. Absolutely, that's correct. I'm Ken Lane, the budget officer. Yes, we're going through the assessments right now, but the assessments essentially are the appropriation less cash on hand divided by production from the prior year. So,
and is there industry support for this since it's a fee increase?
We haven't heard industry support or opposition at this point.
Senator Lowenthal, I have a suggestion, but do you have a question before I offer?
Yeah, I'm just wondering, as representing a district that has significant both onshore and offshore oil and gas recovery, how would these additional positions impact such a district such as mine, which is the oil fields?
I would like to be particular to your district. The largest oil field currently produces 35,500 barrels per day. It's Wilmington Oil Field, and
Right. You're
correct. It's onshore and offshore, and you also have the added issue in your district of subsidence control.
Right.
And so at the current assessment rate of 10.5 cents per barrel, the division would collect, just under $400,000 just in your field alone if production remains stagnant. But there is a company, a large operator in your district, who I will not name, who plans on increasing drilling operations by 300%.
Is that gas?
No, oil. Oil with just some residual natural gas that's produced with those fluids. So they're making the plan, the oil. That oil field is an old one. It's complex because of the complications of the existence of old oil wells that cannot be entered because of the degree of subsidence. You know, they're damaged.
Very significant issues.
Extremely significant. We also have an intensity of urbanization, and so there are all these wells onshore that have been built upon. Derek mentioned construction site review. It's tremendously important that when somebody wants to build something or move forward with their oil and gas project in your district, that we review all of those wells. And many of them, you can't get to them because there's an apartment building on them. So my staff have to find engineering solutions so that the operator's project is not shut down, but some way can improve. I've had a tremendous amount of support by a couple of the operators, a small one in particular in your district, that put out a press release for financing. They were extremely complimentary of the hiring I've done, of the improvements in my engineering review, in the capabilities of my engineering staff, and this just came out in a press release seeking investments in their company. I was startled that it came out because I hadn't heard that they were going to be so complimentary.
You know, you remind me of a friend I had who was bragging on himself, and I said, you know, you're not very modest. And he said, well, I prefer honesty to modesty, which I thought was a great response. So I think if you've got your questions answered, Senator Lowenthal, what I'd like to do is say this and make a recommendation and see if where the committee is. On the one hand, I applaud your determination to take your organization and make it a 21st century functional operation. On the other hand, this is the second year in a row, as I say, where we've got folks showing up with pretty significant changes late in the party. Last year it was because you were new and determined to move your organization forward. This year we've got a new administration. Next year, I don't think any of us want to hear that there's a new reason for a late proposal arriving. My recommendation to the committee would be that we just literally split this one in half and say, take the positions, demonstrate that you're doing good work with them, come back next year through the regular budget process for a robust discussion about what you've done with the positions that were authorized last year, with any positions that are authorized this year, and with a justification early for whatever positions you're still asking for, if any, next year. And that would allow for a more orderly growth in the organization. And it would allow you to demonstrate that they're doing good work, and it would allow you to come to us on a timely basis next year. I can support that today, but only with the proviso that there isn't a snowball's chance I'm going to vote for another position if it comes at the May revise next year. Just, okay, fool me once, fool me twice, but fool me a third time, and then truly shame on me. I don't know whether there's support for that, but let's see where the
members are. So tell me again what we're doing.
The request would be for 36 positions,
right.
And $4.7 million to be budgeted for that purpose, understanding that it comes from the fees. And what we would say instead is let's look at 18 positions and $2.3 million, basically cut the request in half.
Half. So provide them 18 additional positions.
And then Senator Fuller.
And so then I would be interested in, if you get 18 positions, how many of those are going to be IT?
Well, we haven't made that assessment. We're hearing this for the first time today, so we haven't made that calculation.
This is one of the challenges of having items arise during the
okay.
May revise.
Yeah. Well, okay, let me ask it another way. As you know, I'm significantly interested in you being able to expedite the permitting system that you're trying to work with. And so I'm trying to determine at this late date, at this moment, it's a little late, a little difficult for me with not enough information to determine if adding IT positions in particular is going to expedite that permitting. So I guess that's the first question, and then we'll move to the second question.
Maybe just to help, the way that I, when we were looking at this, we kind of categorized the positions into three categories. One were the engineers, the other were the IT support, and the other was general support staff. So those are kind of the three broad categories. And if the recommendation is for 18 positions, the committee certainly may have the option of saying how many would be for each of the three categories.
Let me make a suggestion. We did this earlier with the conversation with PUC. I'm guessing that if it was a choice between zero positions coming out of committee today or 18 with a commitment from the division to have the numbers in front of us for how you'd allocate the funds within the next 24 hours, that you could probably make that happen in a short turnaround. Am I guessing right on that one? Yes? No? Hang on just a second, Senator.
Correct.
Okay. I personally am prepared to say if you can stay within the number 18 and stay within the number 2.3 million, then I can support that. I personally don't want to then sort of parse where you think. I'm guessing that if you get half the requests that you've got, and you know, we have another budget subcommittee on the assembly side and a budget process that follows this one, but if you were to get half them, I'm guessing that it's not as simple as simply saying we want half as many of these and half as many of those, and you're going to have different priorities if you're looking at a small number of folks. So I'm prepared to let that go as long as we can get a timely response. I don't know where other members will be on that. Senator Lowenthal, then back to Senator.
Yeah, as a member who represents one of the largest, if not the largest, with offshore and onshore recovery programs of both gas and oil, and hopefully gas also underneath that oil, that Wilmington oil field. Whether we do the IT engineers, IT or the engineers, I would like to hear how that enhances the recovery in those fields. That whatever we do, this is a driving engine for the California economy. We're not doing new wells out there. We're not doing more offshore drilling, but we are enhancing the process both to use existing kinds of wellheads and to figure out how we can enhance the production, what's possible, where is it possible to do using that, and also onshore. I'd really be interested to see the impact upon the existing system, you know, how we enhance that existing system and that the monies be used for that. I think that's critical and also in safety issues, too. We do not want any kinds of issues around safety issues.
Understood.
Thank you. Senator Fuller.
So if we were to give you these 18 positions, how much of the backlog in permitting would you be able to reduce before you come back to us again?
Senator Fuller, we are working today on that backlog, and my goal is to have the staff that we just hired going to your district office. The district that I have in your district is our Bakersfield district office. There are currently, I believe, 35 underground injection control projects in the queue in that office, and those are a priority. But we are issuing permits in your office every week, and on my website you can now look at our weekly summary to see how many permits are issued. Last week there were 165 permits applied for in your district. We issued 120 permits in 1 week. So we've already started to improve. In terms of these positions, I can't quantify that for you today, but I understand that there's been a request by the senator to give you some guidance in terms of the breakdown of those numbers. Perhaps we can work on that later this afternoon when I get to my office.
It would be important to me to understand the direct nexus between reducing the backlog and these positions, since that has been a problem for over a year now. And I am struggling a little bit at supporting this proposal because I'm not completely certain. And when I look at the proportion, for example, if the proportion was largely support services, I wouldn't be in support. If it was largely IT, I wouldn't be in support. If there was some larger combination of engineers and some much smaller ratio, then I might be likely if you are able to give me some estimates about what you think your output is. I'm sort of at the stage where we've got so many demands on us that it's very hard for me to look at granting personnel on the basis of input. I need is an input, and I will do is an output. And so I would think that you would be prepared today to have some type of output. For every person you're going to add, they can add some amount of output as an estimate. So what's the 24 hours?
First on this issue, I think. I'm guessing that the division would make the case that even, or perhaps even particularly, support and IT staff play a role in reducing the backlog.
Yes.
And, you know, this is always the challenge in terms of support and IT functions is to what extent do they provide what you and I might characterize as a direct benefit. So that I'll toss that out there. Second, I'm prepared to, support the measure today. And Senator Fuller, it's your vote, of course, but I wouldn't trouble the chair at all if you held off and sent the message that not only do we need more data before we're going to look at 18 positions next year, but that you need more data before you're even going to look at 18 positions this year. And I think that's the message we're trying to communicate here. On the one hand, we want to see the work get done. We want to see it get done on a timely basis. We want to make sure that both community concerns as well as industry concerns are being dealt with and responded to. On the other hand, we've got a growth in staffing that's very aggressive, very quick, and very last minute by virtue of our process. And I appreciate the acknowledgement up front about that. So, I don't want to be a finger-wagging chastiser about process and not move the program forward if that's the thing to do. On the other hand, you know, we've got an obligation to make sure that the money is well spent. It's not an insignificant fee increase for folks. We want to make sure that the money is well spent. So the 24 hours is just more sort of a negotiating and reporting back what the use of the funds will be, because as a budget process matter, as I understand it, finance is going to tell us we need to know what that is so we can put it in the budget, yes?
Actually, you've given us everything that we need, 18 positions and $2.3 million, we can build that in, and then the details, we will be notifying you what the ultimate split of the 18 is based on the categories or whatever, but you can take an action now and that's sufficient for us.
Oh, and that's a report back after the fact. So, Senator, do we have any other comments on this item before we ask for a vote? I know Senator Lowenthal has to be in two places at once in just 5 minutes, so I want to try and wrap this item up. All right, motion by Senator
Lowenthal,
18 positions.
Right, to split the baby in half.
$0.3
million. And to take the top half of the baby.
And I just want to be very, very clear. We're absolutely positively clear. I want to see four nodding heads here. You get off, Ms. Roberts. We're not going to get proposals for new positions in the May revise next year. We are going to hear from you in January if there's anything you want to see in the coming budget year. And we're going to get a report back on both the 17 positions last year and whatever positions get approved this year in the process. Nodding heads all around?
Sir. Yeah.
Great. Thank you. Call the roll.
Senator Smidian?
Aye.
Senator Fuller? Senator Lowenthal?
Aye.
I'm calling that a no, but waiting for the record. Okay.
All right.
Two to one. All right. Measure passes. All right, folks, here's what we're going to do. We're going to take a five-minute break right now, since Senator Lawhassey. We will be back just a little after 11:30. Then we're going to run until 12:30, at which time we're going to take an hour-and-a-half break from 12:30 to 2. So five-minute break right now. Back in 5 minutes. That's a real 5 minutes, not a legislative 5 minutes. And then we will continue until 12:30. Thank you. We're in recess. exception I'm going to make to that is the Department of the California Highway Patrol, I believe, is sitting here. Yes? Raising hand, somebody? Yes. What I'm going to do is I'm going to ask that you come up, that we take you up do this one briefly. It's a vote-only item, as I understand it. Is that correct, looking to staff? And we do have staff present. Rather than have you come back at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, I'd rather that you go help make us safe somewhere, okay? So why don't you come on up? And without objection, members, we're looking at the first